Ms. Burke?
Yes.
This morning, good afternoon, Binghamton.
Good afternoon.
Come on, let's a little more. Come on. Good afternoon, Binghamton.
Good afternoon.
And are all those New York City people still here paying attention? Yes? Come up. I wanted to say nice things about you when you're standing next to me. And I have to tell you, when Zephyr Teachout was standing to my left, maybe you should sit to my right. I was her treasurer in the 2014 campaign, and I spent a lot of time talking to her about a lot of things. And I have to tell you, until I prepared my remarks today to introduce her, there was a lot of things about her I didn't know. So I have to tell you some of these things, right? Zephyr Teachout has led a nomadic life. I'm going to tell you how. She was born in Seattle. I got this from Wikipedia. It's got to be right, right? She's the daughter of a constitutional law professor and a judge. She was raised on a farm in Norwich, Vermont, wherever that is. She attended Hanover High School in Hanover, New Hampshire, so she moved over a state. She was a champion cross-country runner. Maybe still is. She got her BA from Yale in 1993. In 1999, she graduated from Duke Law School with a JD summa cum laude and a master's in political science. She then clerked for the chief judge of the Third Circuit U.S. Court of Appeals. She was a visiting law professor after that at Duke, and then she became an associate professor at Fordham University. Sounds like the qualifications of someone who should be on the Supreme Court, right? She hasn't run for that yet. In 2004, Zephyr was the director of internet organizing for the Howard Dean campaign, something a lot of people probably don't know. And she ran all over the country with Howard Dean, which I'm sure was like almost as crazy as running around with Bernie, just for a shorter period of time. In 2009, she became the first national director of the Sunlight Foundation, which is a foundation that called for transparency in government. In 2011, which is when I met Zephyr, she was part of the Occupy movement. I don't know if she slept at, I have a feeling she slept several nights down there, but she was one of the leaders of the legal committee, which was mostly not lawyers, and which insisted on discussing every legal issue until there was consensus, which meant the meetings went on a long time. And she was very patient with people and taught them a lot about the law. In 2014, the Working Families Party, and I don't want to put down the Working Families Party that much. In 2014, the Working Families Party recruited, trained, and got her a treasurer and a lawyer. I was the treasurer. And then they abandoned her. But she ran anyway. And she ran with Columbia law professor Tim Wu. They ran basically an 8-week campaign. It was amazing. Her program was rolling back Cuomo's tax cuts for the wealthy. Not much has changed, right? Investment in transportation and broadband infrastructure, statewide fracking ban, an end to Common Core testing, full funding for public schools, supporting the New York Dream Act, enacting anti-corruption ethics laws in Albany, and public financing of elections, among other issues that are still on the agenda. My God, we haven't achieved any of them. Although right after the election, Governor Cuomo did do a temporary ban on fracking, which was all thanks to Zephyr. Zephyr raised in those 8 weeks about $800,000. In that campaign, she got 34% of the vote. And there was another candidate, Randy Credico, who got 5%. Tim Wu got 40%. So she basically, the two candidates brought out 40% of the Democratic Party in an 8-week campaign to go against a governor who had $24 million that he spent on the campaign. And Zephyr won most of the counties north of Westchester. This morning, I said that we have to knock off the inept leadership of the Democratic Party if we're going to move forward. And Zephyr is the political, in my opinion, political and ideological mother of our organization and of our movement here in New York. At the end of Zephyr's campaign, I told her that we had to take her campaign energy and launch a group out of it. And with a little help from Bernie, we're here with NYPAN. Last year, Zephyr ran for Congress in her new home, she's still running, right? In Dutchess County in the 19th Congressional District. She was endorsed by Bernie Sanders and Robert Mercer, who was the main philanthropist who gave money to Trump, gave $1 million to her opponent, John Faso. Zephyr lost by a small amount. In 2017, as the year opened, Zephyr became one of the attorneys in a suit brought by a group called the Citizens for Responsibility and Ethics in Washington. That's an oxymoron. They brought a lawsuit against Donald Trump for violating the Emoluments Clause of the U.S. Constitution. I want to tell one last story that she usually tells, but I'm going to tell it. When Zephyr was growing up, her dad, often she lived on a farm, right? Her dad had a bull who he'd like to take out for a walk. So he would let the bull out of the pen, but the bull didn't like to go back into the pen. The bull didn't really like being penned in, right? So that's where Zephyr's job came in. Zephyr would walk up to the bull, tickle him on the nose, and then run as fast as she can back into the pen with the bull chasing her. Her dad would crawl, close the fence, and she would climb out. And when she ran for governor and for Congress, Zephyr would say, that's how she learned how to run. That's enough. I'd like to introduce, I'll call her the godmother of our movement here in New York, Zephyr Teachout.
All right, well, thank you for that incredible introduction. It's about 93% correct. One of the things that happens when you run for public office is you give up the sort of fantasy that you control your own public image and what's said on the internet. So how many people here are in public office again? And how many people are running for public office or planning to run? That's really, really exciting. I was really, thank you to all the members of the last panel. I was entranced. And I think we all were, with the stories and the detail, and every single one of you brought something that was incredibly true and important. So I just actually want to give them one more round of applause. I'm going to talk about money in politics. Because I believe, as you believe, in clean air, clean water, union jobs, good jobs, actual real fair trade, not stuff they call fair trade, real fair trade. I believe in fully funding our public education. I believe in tearing down Common Core. I believe in busting up big banks. I believe in busting up Monsanto. I believe in publicly financed elections. And I believe in having a sense of humor in politics. That was a great point, Jim. and I believe that these are really not that complicated things to want. And this root issue of money in politics is in the way of people getting to live in that thriving economy that we all want to live in, where we can all have equal dignity. So I'm going to talk about money in politics. I am going to talk about Donald Trump a little bit. And then I'm going to talk about money in politics and the Democratic Party and what we need to, you know, how we need to look ourselves in the mirror. And then a few things that I think we should all be focused on doing. So the money in politics I want to start with is Chinese money and our president. On the day that our president took office, he began violating the Constitution. I wrote a book that some of you guys may have known called From Benjamin Franklin, Corruption in America, From Benjamin Franklin's Snuffbox to Citizens United. And in that book, I talk about a clause called the Emoluments Clause. Which most people until about 3 months ago thought was sort of something you put on your arm. because it's this sort of once forgotten part of our Constitution, but actually really represents a key commitment of our country against corruption and particularly against foreign corruption. But when I wrote about it in that book, and Benjamin Franklin's snuffbox is actually a reference to that clause, I never imagined that we would have a president who would violate it. So I just want to play law professor for a minute and explain what is happening, because I actually think it's really important for this moment. Because we have a president who is not merely cruel and callous about people's lives, work, healthcare, education, and health. We have a president and administration that is thumbing his nose in the most aggressive way at the rule of law itself. And you might hear the word rule of law bandied about, but this is a hard-fought thing, that we are governed by laws, not men. That we have the same rules applied to us as opposed to the whims of a tyrant who can choose to have one rule apply to one person and another apply to another. And we have a president who, in a series of ways, and administration, a series of ways, have shown that they are not just dismissive of truth, but of this sort of basic idea of law and of the rule of law. And one of the ways in which he shows this is by violating the Emoluments Clause. So what the Emoluments Clause says is, and there's no like titles to sections of the Constitution, so it's sometimes called the Foreign Gifts Clause, sometimes called the Title of Nobility Clause. It says that if you are an officer of the United States, you cannot take gifts, emoluments, offices, or titles of nobility, so four different things, of any kind whatever, from foreign governments, unless you go to Congress and get explicit consent from Congress. So it's actually one of these weird clauses in the Constitution that tells you how to read it. It has of any kind whatever in it, this like kind of petulant phrase. So we know that it encompasses the broad reading of all those kinds of things. And gifts, you understand, emoluments are basically situations in which you can make a profit. So that covers business relationships. Our president, by maintaining his business relationships, is violating this in four ways and was violating it from the minute he took office. One is probably the one you've heard the most about, where foreign diplomats are staying in his hotels. That's money into his pocket. The second is Trump Tower. I know there's a bunch of New York City people here. Trump Tower in New York City, the UAE and the Chinese government are two tenants in Trump Tower. And in fact, the Chinese government is one of the largest tenants in Trump Tower. It's through the Commercial and Industrial Bank of China. So that is money going from the Chinese government into our president's pocket while we are negotiating our relationship, our trade relationship with China, while we are negotiating how we are going to engage with China in relationship to the North Korean nuclear threat. The third way is through the apprentice and the celebrity apprentice, the new celebrity apprentice. In two countries, the royalties from that, which still flow to our president, come from government-owned entities. And then the fourth way, which you've also probably heard about, but is really, really important, is these Trump development projects around the world, in Saudi Arabia, in China, in Turkey. And with those development projects, those governments are in a position to basically give things of value to our president by giving a permit, let alone by speeding up a permit. But as anybody involved in development or real estate knows, that's actually worth a lot of money. But sometimes I think people think of this as a sort of a mere technical violation. There's some kind of glee in catching the president in a constitutional violation. There's no glee. It's very, very destabilizing to have a constitutional violation. But this is just basic human nature. We have the government of, let's just use China for an example. The government of China is in a position to make our president richer or poorer. And this is a president who doesn't like anybody talking about how poor he is. In fact, has told comedians in the past, you can talk about anything, my private life, but just don't joke about my bankruptcies, because that's really sensitive. While we are in the middle of figuring out what our trade and military relationships are with the world. So this is deeply, deeply destabilizing on a common sense level as well as on a constitutional level. So we filed a lawsuit. The government response is fairly soon, April 22nd, and you should be hearing a lot more about that as that comes. But, But while we talk about what is happening with the presidency, and I do actually believe that's something that people around the country do not want. It wasn't something that came up a lot during the campaign, this kind of direct conflict, as much as some of the other concerns with the president. But there's this sort of deep, I think, real tragedy with the election of President Trump. Because my district, which went for Donald Trump by over 7%, and around the country, in the districts that did go, that really swung hard for President Trump, and I was in a district that Obama won handily 4 years before, so one of these real swing areas. The biggest thing that I heard, and I'm sure all of you heard, is that people were sick and tired of the corruption that they felt in Washington. And the tragedy, it's almost funny. I mean, that line between tragedy and comedy is always hard. But it really is a tragedy, because people, you know, I talked to one guy the day after the election who didn't like Donald Trump, but I think voted for him, who said, "I just wanted to put a stick in the stream. I just wanted something to change." And there's a lot of other things, including race and bigotry that went into some of the votes there. But there was another part, which is this incredible, I mean, we are in a revolutionary moment. And Bernie absolutely tapped into that. But we have to be honest about Trump voters who also were tapping into that, wanting something fundamental to change. The tragedy is that we have an administration who is threatening to be one of the most corrupt administrations we've ever had, not the most corrupt and corrupting administrations we've ever had, coming out of an anti-corruption fervor. And so what we have to do is not merely correctly call out and sue and protest against this president who is threatening the fundamentals of our shared agreement to come together and govern ourselves. But if we ignore the reason that so many people were feeling like there was so much corruption in our system, we really ignored it at our own peril. Some of that is strategic, but it's actually more deeply moral. I'll talk about the strategic part for a second and then the moral part. The strategic part is that we as Democrats, as Leslie was saying, we had a tradition. I'm an FDR Democrat, and I'm proud of it. FDR, as a sitting president, called the Wall Street oligarch princes of power trying to destroy our economy. He wasn't scared to name names and say that we as Democrats stand for the little guy. And we stand against these middlemen who are trying to extract, in our case, extract fossil fuels from the ground, but also extract wealth from our economy and take it all for themselves. Extract power from our communities and take it all for themselves. And if we as Democrats do not stand for that, we will be left as a bit of a question mark in people's minds. This is apocryphal. Phil can confirm this if this is true. Phil from the Working Families Party. At the Working Families Party retreat, I heard this story about an Iowa focus group where people were asked what a Democrat was and what a Republican was. And they were asked to draw a picture. And so the plurality of people drew a dollar sign for the Republican. And a plurality of people drew a question mark for the Democrat. And if we do not know who we are and that one of our core jobs is to stand against the people and the big companies that are trying to take over our government and our wealth and our environment, then we will continue to be a question mark. That's the strategic part. But the more deeply moral part is that we can't stand for the clean air and clean water we need if at the same time we are being silent about fossil fuel infrastructure because of who's paying our candidates. Yes. And I gotta say, so often corruption and money in politics doesn't work to lead to loud shills, loud voices. It leads to silence. Because if there's a lot of big donors on the line who say, I'll tell you, as a candidate running for office, one of the biggest things I hear when I was calling through sort of traditional donors is, well, I don't agree with you on teachers unions. I'm a strong supporter of opponent of the anti-union charter school effort and very vocal about it. But I'll tell you, a lot of donors will talk about that and not on the same side of that. And I think what that leads to is not necessarily Democrats all out there pushing the charter school movement, although we do see that, but also just a lot of silence on the part of Democrats who would otherwise be standing up. And we got to understand that there's a money and politics connection to that. We got to understand that, do you guys remember that great presidential speech about the importance of unions?
Yeah.
In the last 20 years? I don't either. We got to be clear that we stand with unions and that democracy depends on unions. Democratic donors might be very happy with some parts of the liberal agenda, but don't want to hear about union power because that's something that's getting in their way. We got to be clear, if we want to break up the big banks, which we better well do, and that is a popular position. If we want to not just break up the big banks, but like, let's take on all the monopolies that we have in our society. Let's bring some Teddy Roosevelt trust busting back. Choking concentration that so many people feel that affects how workers can negotiate for their jobs, that has led to incredible inequality as a handful of companies are controlling every sector, whether it's food or seeds or cable or banking. If we're going to do that, we got to be honest about the current effects that the big banks have played in the big money politics. So Joe said something important actually on the last panel. Not actually. Of course Joe said something. What Joe said is we have to be honest about money, but not be so disdainful. I think of something like, we have to be honest that you need money to run for office and not just automatically criticize anybody who raises any money. So you have to do something that's hard. It's a lot harder. It's easier to either take the money and be quiet, which honestly many Democrats have done, or say, hey, I'm not even going to engage. I'm not even going to engage in this system. I'm done. I'm out. I'm not going to be involved in politics the way that it's run, which a lot of other people have done, especially a lot of young people have done, just checking out. But you have to do something really hard. Bernie Sanders did a really great job of this, is you have to both raise the money and criticize the way the money is raised at the same time so that you can move forward. We have to raise the money to reach people. And I'm really proud that in my campaign, we had the highest percentage of any federal race, congressional or Senate, of low dollar donors in the country. Our average contribution made the Bernie Sanders donors seem like, you know, the rich kids. It was $19. But you know what? We needed every single penny of that because we were up against some of the biggest money forces in the country. And after I got in the race, Arthur mentioned this, but Robert Mercer, there's a recent New Yorker article, which I encourage everybody to read, by Jane Mayer, about Robert Mercer, who's a hedge funder who is the biggest investor in the Trump campaign, and his daughter is incredibly close to the Trump organization. Our campaign was the second biggest investment of the Mercers, as far as we can tell, in the country. By our campaign, I mean not on my side. And we do have this surreal moment where, you know, I actually challenged Mercer to a debate because you're spending over $500,000 in my district and you don't seem to have any connections to the district. Well, let's come talk about the flooding from Irene and what you think about it. He didn't respond, he just put more money in for my opponent. But we are we gotta be honest about that. I mean, we're in a crisis moment, like just no kidding about the crisis moment. That doesn't mean we do less work, it means we do more. But the surreal thing about running today is that you're actually not running against your opponent. In some cases, you're running against the super PACs.
Yep.
So my opponent spent under $2 million in the general election, and the super PAC that Mercer was funding spent over $3 million. So that if you're a citizen in my district, you're far more likely to be hearing from Robert Mercer than my opponent. So like, let's be real about how serious a problem this is. And so what I forgot to put out the framework, but basically there's two big money in politics problems. One is how we raise money just generally. You know, how private financing of election corrupts our candidacy and corrupts our democracy. And the other is the super PACs and the outside money. And it's hard, but we gotta fight against both of them. And we gotta fight against them by one, making sure, now I bet you every candidate up here will do that, but making sure that every candidate that we work for and support and engage with is supportive of publicly financed elections. The money and politics system, but you're still supporting a privately financed election system, you are supporting a system that is corrupting us. Two, we gotta support each other in learning from all of these grassroots campaigns that actually you can raise a lot more low dollar by going with a strong progressive message. And showing and proving in race after race that these $19 average races, it's not gonna work in every race. And as Joe said, I'm not gonna blame people as long as they don't ever sell out based on a no. That's the key. But for those of you running for office, just make yourself a sign somewhere, or just know it in your heart, I will never change my position and I will never be silent because of a donor. Just know that. And if you know that and you repeat that mantra to yourself, as corrupting as this system is, you're gonna feel a lot better because you're gonna know. Somebody says, oh, well, I wish, why do you have to be so loud about the TPP against it? And you'll know that it's not gonna make a difference. Really, really important. So those are things we have to do. And then we have to continue. And this is a tough moment for this. And I like, it's like, no kidding how tough it is. We have to make sure that we do everything we can to block Judge Gorsuch because it is the moral thing to do. I know the odds ain't great, but the more that we collectively keep saying that we cannot support a Supreme Court justice who wants to affirm and extend Citizens United and the right of corporations to speak in our elections, the more power we can have, even in the thinking of those justices on the Supreme Court. So we've got to keep up that fight. All right. Let's see. Oh my goodness. Where's my little person saying time? Am I on time?
You're okay.
I'm okay? Okay.
All right.
Yeah. So one thing, that's an immediate thing that's happening this week with Gorsuch, but it's also, as everybody on the panel said before, change is not going to happen. We're never going to have as much money as they are. We're never going to have the Robert Mercer spending. You know, there might be exceptions, a handful of exceptions, but en masse, the sort of nihilists who want to fundamentally get rid of our government are going to have more money on their side. And the only way that we can actually fight for the society that we want to live in is through the insistent social community that we're building from the ground up with these races and with your activism and organizing you're doing. It is really the only way. It's absolutely, absolutely essential. One other thing that relates to money and politics and relates to breaking up big banks that I think is really important, and I just want to emphasize that somebody mentioned this on the panel earlier, is the importance. Well, I think it actually was a strain throughout the panel of listening and of humility. So again, to hold two complicated thoughts in your head. One, it's incredible anger that this person could have voted for Donald Trump. And two, incredible love for that person and humility that you want to listen to what they have to say. And I got to tell you, in 2009, I went to a lot of Tea Party events. I'm a grassroots organizer. I wanted to see what was going on. Also, I was trying to break up big banks, and I thought we could recruit and we did actually recruit some people. I mean, there are a lot of different tea parties. But one of the things that I heard over and over was that people felt like they were out of power. And the Tea Party gave them an answer for why they were out of power, which is that big government had taken it away from them. And far too often, the Democratic response, I think, has been to somebody saying, I am out of power. It doesn't feel like if I scream, I will be heard. The Democratic response has been, you're wrong, you're not out of power. Your experience isn't accurate. But the truth is, people are out of power right now. And they're out of power because of big money, and they're out of power because of big monopolies. Yes. And that we as Democrats, as truth tellers, must answer that incredible desire, not just for a decent wage, which is so important, not just for clean air, which is so important, and clean water, but actually for the dignity of knowing that you have power in your own democracy, is that we have to answer that by being able to look at ourselves in the mirror, look at the society as a whole, and saying, you're right. You are out of power, and we are going to do every single thing we can to make sure that you have a louder voice next year, and the year after that, and the year after that. So, practically, I got to mention it because it's really important in New York State, even though you guys, there's some New York City people here. One of the most important things we can do in New York State is take this incredible energy, and it's everywhere I go, and make sure that New York State stands as the counter to this corrupting Washington. We would need to actually have voting rights that were strong in this country instead of some of the worst voting rights laws in the country. And in order to get there, we need to take on the IDC, the Independent Democratic Caucus. And make sure that there are consequences for Democrats who caucus with Republicans who are blocking the law. Account and not allowing him to get away with big speeches in January that turn into a vanished line items in March. We got a lot of loud voices on voting rights here in this room. We've got to act on that and closing the LLC loophole, which is New York's own private Citizens United, where corporations can give directly. To candidates, as they gave to Andrew Cuomo when I ran against him. It's funny, it's like men spend a lot of money against me. and for those of you who are doing trainings, work with NYPAN, work with Trailblazers, work with the Working Families Party has already trained 1,000 people this year. So exciting, and it was like 6 people who were usually there and about 70 who were right on the fence about whether they're going to run or not. Those are the kinds of people we need to be training. So there's very, very practical things that you can do right now. But we as a state, just to return to like what New York State can be, we have a really long ways to go. And a short time to get there, as they say. But I actually believe that there's the possibility of 2017 in our local races being a real watershed year that can shake up not just the governor and not just the Republicans, but everybody in this state to say, come on, we can't just be sort of mouthing off anti-Trump as New Yorkers. That's not enough. We've actually got to show an alternative vision where every person has equal dignity, and we've got to go back to our FDR roots as Democrats.